Cyprus has not always been like this. The purling water flowing in abundance was once a rare sight, as it quickly evaporated before it could course very far on a ground scorched by the sweltering summer months. Since ancient times, the inhabitants of the island, in addition to their never-ending struggles against foreign invaders, had to fight another, more ruthless enemy. Drought. All over the country, one can see the vestiges of the ceaseless efforts by Cypriots to solve the water shortage problem with the manual means they have at their disposal, collecting rainwater and storing it drop by drop for their needs. There are waterworks from all the historic periods scattered throughout the island, whether individual or collective. Stone Age basins and canals cut in the rock, ancient or medieval cisterns and wells, as well as fountains and springs. Impressive waterworks have come to light in all of the major archaeological sites like Salamis, Paphos, Amathus, Kurion, and more recently in what is believed to be the island's most ancient capital, the fabled Ledra in Nicosia. One of the most ingenious and imposing must have been the aqueduct carrying water from the fountainhead of Githrea on the contours of the Pentadactylos range to Salamis, 50 kilometers away to the east. The Roman aqueduct outside Larnaca, known as Camares or Arches, has fared better, with a large part of it standing intact to this day. The anxious effort to secure this most precious commodity lives in the popular myths and fairy tales about the water dragon and other awesome creatures of rivers and springs. In the early Christian era, the drought was so prolonged and intense that many of the inhabitants abandoned the island and the snakes came out of their holes looking for water. It was then that, according to tradition, St. Helen brought the cats here from Constantinople to get rid of the serpents. Today, the numerous feline colony at the convent of Agios Nikolaos in Limassol may rest on their laurels, since there's enough water for all, thanks to the quenching policy of the state following independence. The natural springs and sources that gushed here and there, depending on the prevailing weather conditions, helped the Cypriots survive during the difficult years of their history. Many of them were turned into public fountains made of cement by the colonial government in 1953 and thereafter to honor the coronation of Queen Elizabeth, presenting them as donations to the loyal subjects. The British also constructed cement canals and some small water dams for water supply and irrigation purposes. The large number of boreholes drilled was to have a long-term negative effect on the island's underground water deposits. Perhaps the only colonial project that withstood effectively the test of time was the Water Supply and Irrigation Department, set up as early as 1896 and renamed the Water Development Department in 1954, as it's known to this day. Reinforced with dedicated qualified staff and modern equipment after independence in 1960, it became the powerhouse for the water policy of successive governments. Under the slogan, "Not a drop of water to the sea," more than 100 large and small dams have been constructed in the 46-year-long life of the Republic of Cyprus, able to hold over 300 million cubic meters of water. Some of them have been left in the occupied part of the island following the Turkish invasion of 1974. It's worth noting that Cyprus ranks first among European countries in the list of the International Commission for Large Dams for the number of dams in proportion to its area of 9,251 square kilometres. In combination with the water dams, some major water projects have also been constructed. The Paphos irrigation project using water from the Asprogramos dam was completed in 1982. The Vasilikos Pendaskinos project, finished in 1987, serves both irrigation and water supply purposes for the districts of Nicosia, Larnaca and Famagusta, while the Chrysochou irrigation project was completed in two successive phases in 1988 and 1998. A project that stands apart is that of the Southern Conveyor, a 110-kilometre underground pipe carrying water from the Kouris Dam, the island's largest with a capacity of 115 million cubic metres, to the Kokinohoria area in the east. It began in 1987 and was completed in 1994, watering 13,926 hectares of coastal farmland between Limassol and Famagusta. It also serves the water supply needs of four towns, as well as those of tourism and industry. The project includes a 14.5-kilometre-long diversion from the Diarizos River in Paphos to the Kouris Dam, and another diversion of 36 kilometres from Tersefanu to Nicosia. The water used in all these projects comes mainly from the annual rainfall and some snow on the highest peaks. With an average precipitation of 477 millimetres, 1951 to 1980 statistics, it's estimated that 4,400 million cubic metres of water fall on Cyprus every year. Unfortunately, most of it evaporates and returns to where it came from, leaving only about 780 million cubic meters to bank on. From this quantity, the largest part stays on the ground. A certain volume is deposited in the dams or seeps into the earth to enrich underground aquifers, while the remainder finds its way to the sea. The water needs of Cyprus reach about 270 million cubic meters every year, with irrigated crops having the lion's share, 185 million cubic meters. The remaining water resources of about 85 million cubic meters are used to cover the household, tourist, and industrial needs of the country. This makes it obvious that the available surface and underground water deposits are not enough at any given moment to satisfy all water requirements without risking the conservation of reserves in case of a prolonged drought. A sudden decrease in average rainfall nearing 20% since the 1970s is already causing concern, as it translates into twice that reduction for water flowing into the dams. This goes to explain why water rationing had been imposed during the summer months for many years. This negative situation has led the government, through the competent Water Development Department, to adopt a new approach to the management of water resources, consisting of the implementation of water conservation measures, while at the same time utilizing non-conventional water sources in residential areas. Beginning in 1997, an awareness campaign addressed both to households and farmers focused on practical methods of saving drinking water and using improved irrigation systems. It was coupled by regular monitoring of the water supply networks, aiming to minimize leaks. At the same time, the government introduced a series of subsidies, which includes the drilling of boreholes and their connection to the toilet flush, as well as the installing of grey water recycling systems in households, schools, factories and other organised units connected to public water supply networks. In this way, consumers are encouraged to use lesser quality water for their gardens and lavatories saving potable water for general use in the same town or community. In April 1997, the first desalination plant went into production in the Gheia, to be followed in 2001 by a second one in the Larnaca airport area. Together they turn out 33 million cubic meters of water, which, added to the 34 million cubic meters from dams and another 18 million cubic meters from boreholes, satisfy the water supply needs of Cyprus in full. The construction of a third desalination plant in Limassol is moving fast. In the framework of the new policy and in harmonization with the European acquis, the government has started to apply systematically the use of recycled water from household and industrial waste in irrigation, combined with the construction and operation of sewerage systems across the free areas of Cyprus. This program will be completed in 2012 and comprises the four big urban centers of Nicosia, Limassol, Larnaca and Paphos, the tourist areas of Agia Napa and Paralimni, as well as 38 rural communities. Already a plant for the processing of household and industrial waste is in operation, while President Papadopoulos recently laid the foundation stone to a water recycling plant as part of the wider Nicosia sewerage system. When the project is completed in 2009, it'll be able to process 13,000 cubic meters of liquid waste every day. The continuing concern of the state for the sufficiency and quality of water has had multiple beneficial effects, which can be seen in the welfare and the health of the population, contributing significantly to sustainable development and the improvement of the environment.